New email showing top Clinton advisor Cheryl Mills was privately worried that the family's charitable foundation needed to clean up glaring conflicts of interest around the overlapping nonprofit and the money-making machine known as Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton was using the charity for his own purposes. Here's what Mills was worried about. She circulated a memo in December 2011 that said, quote, currently the president personally compensates certain workers to perform duties that fall outside of the scope of the foundation entity's mission. And these workers support the president's business, his personal, basically former president, and his political activity, while also providing support for foundation activity for which their services are then billed to the foundation. You know, there was so much concern about it that Chelsea Clinton called it, quote, an existing muddle. And it turns out, though, that one of the people at the foundation collecting outside income, it was her father. He was paid a salary of $3.5 million a year by a Clinton confidence consulting company. It's called Tenio. That person, Doug Benn, also co-founded the Clinton Global Initiative. And that came out of the recent book, Man of the World, by author Joe Connison. This latest development is on top of new revelations of a $12 million offer to the Clinton Foundation from the King of Morocco just for a meeting between the King and Bill Clinton and Chelsea Clinton. Also, a $1 million birthday present from Qatar for Bill Clinton that came at a time when Qatar was supporting terrorist organizations, including Al-Qaeda. And don't forget the more than $17 million payday over 5 years for Bill Clinton as honorary chancellor of the for-profit college, Laureate International. Let's take this to author and filmmaker of Hillary's America, Dinesh D'Souza. Good to be with you, sir. Have you seen anything like this with former presidents like FDR, Kennedy, Reagan, or Carter? Has anybody done, any president, done what the Clintons have done?
This is completely unprecedented. Now, we have seen corruption rampant in America in urban city machines run by big bosses like the Tammany Hall rackets in New York a century ago, the Daley rackets in Chicago. But we've never before had a Secretary of State renting out American foreign policy. We've never had an ex-president essentially convert politics into a business. Remember, the Clintons haven't actually produced anything. They've never started a business. They don't. Their product actually is politics and political influence, and that's what they're trading in. And it's really quite a sickening sight.
You know, the Washington Post calculated, they said $3 billion is what the Clintons have raised for their charity and their political activities. The Clintons' net worth are about $111 million. You know, you could say, yes, you know, charity watchdogs say the charity, the Clinton Foundation, does a lot of good, like more than 85% of that money goes to charitable causes. But when you look at the exchange of workers between the different entities, Dinesh, and the political activity, I don't think the United States has ever seen anything like this. And could you point this to the year 2000 when Hillary Clinton decided to run for the Senate, got Al Gore really angry, and that's when the Clinton machine really launched out of the wreckage of what happened with the Monica Lewinsky scandal?
Yeah, the Clintons somehow realized that they were in a very good position to convert their influence into cash, and they could do this very effectively starting in about the year 2000. When the Haiti earthquake exploded, right after that, the Clintons strategically positioned themselves. Mrs. Clinton, of course, was in a position as Secretary of State. And then later, Bill Clinton was appointed by the UN to be the sort of representative for Haiti. And so the two of them were in a position to intercept this huge flow of money, some of it coming from American taxpayers, but much of it also coming from around the world. And they were the sort of gatekeepers of this money. And no surprise, not all of it ended up in Haiti.
Okay, there's more. The Clinton campaign was hard-pressed on connecting Trump's business ties to Russia. You know, there's talk of Donald Trump having a lot of real estate activity going on in Russia. Let's take a listen to this soundbite. I need Dinesh's reaction to it. Take a listen.
You used to criticize me for even talking to the Russians. Now suddenly you're okay with your nominee having a bromance with Putin.
It's clear that he has business dealings with Russian oligarchs who are very connected to Putin.
Maybe because he wants to do business in Moscow. The financial relationship
we're going to get to that later.
That he has
Secretary
with
Clinton,
Russians
you're
and
out
other
of time.
Foreign powers.
Right.
However, the Wall Street Journal now reporting that the latest WikiLeaks emails show that Hillary Clinton's campaign chairman, John Podesta, has long had ties to a Kremlin-backed solar energy company. This company was basically backed by investment that was coming out of the Russian government and the entities there. It's gone. And basically what's happening here is John Podesta went out of his way, according to the Wall Street Journal, to avoid scrutiny of this relationship. Dinesh, what do you make of this?
See, I think we're losing sight of a distinction here. There's absolutely nothing wrong with American businesses doing business around the world. If Trump has business dealings in Russia, so what? If he has business dealings in China, so what? The main issue is that when you are in control of the levers of government, when you are entrusted with public trust, and when you are in charge of the public treasury, that's what makes things completely different. Whatever offenses Trump has committed are in the private domain, but Mrs. Clinton's offenses are against the public trust and the public treasury.
Yeah, it's an important distinction. Next up, we have accusations that Hillary's allies may have influenced the FBI's investigation into the private email server that was used by Hillary Clinton as Secretary of State. We have the former chairman of Bill Clinton's reelection campaign. He's Terry McAuliffe. The Democrat machine out of Virginia basically pointed nearly $700,000 to the wife of the FBI official who was basically helping to oversee that investigation of the FBI. Her name is Dr. Jill McCabe. She was running for office in Virginia. And basically, the journalist saying, wow, this is a heck of a conflict of interest here. Spokespeople for McAuliffe and the FBI told the Wall Street Journal, however, there were not any ties. What do you think, Dinesh?
Well, I just think that this is all so sleazy, isn't it? It's almost like you've just got the Clinton amoeba, and this amoeba stretches its tentacles into every area of government, including the very people who are supposed to be keeping an eye on the Clintons. I think this shows that if Hillary Clinton is elected in November, normally you'd say, look, even if she wants to conduct scams, there will be all kinds of checks and balances, the Justice Department, the House and the Senate, the Supreme Court. But I think it's the goal of the Clintons to neutralize all those checks and balances, to have a court that will rubber stamp what they do, to have a pliable House and Senate that will go along with all their escapades. These people are experts at staying one step ahead of the posse, and they're hoping they can keep doing it.
All right, Dinesh D'Souza, you are a filmmaker, author of Hillary's America. Thank you so much for your time. We really appreciate it, sir.